How do they see me? How do they see me? I've been a lot lately on messages about our walk in our representation. And I know we should never be caught up in how man sees us in the sense of trying to please man. But here's where I start right off throwing the boomerang. But it is important how they see us. We should not be trying to please them or do things to get them to approve of us. But it is important how they see us. You got it? In other words, when I'm not trying to behave for them or act right for them or put on a show for them, when I'm not trying to shout the name of Jesus to make people think I'm more Jesus-y, when I'm just being the me that I am or become, how do they see me? That's been kind of a cry of my heart lately as I've been seeking out what my walk really represents. And God has begun to walk me through the path of people that I've been able to help, and then also people that I may have hurt or disappointed. Sometimes in the right place, me being in the right place, but they're just disappointed with or discouraged by the truth that they are not ready to receive. Sometimes too much of my flesh was in there and I crossed the line and hurt somebody's feelings. Christians don't like to believe that. They don't like to own that. But it's true. Sometimes you it's a little more God, and it's a lot more of you and a lot less God in the situation. It may start as God, and then you start to infuse your emotions into it, and it becomes something that's not godly. So I start to understand in times past and then forget. And God has to re-help me understand. Anybody other than me know what I'm talking about? You get this revelation, you're just like, ooh, hallelujah, yes. And then a little time goes on and you realize you've totally drifted away from that great hallelujah moment, and you're back doing your old BS, and now you gotta have that new hallelujah moment again and relearn that deliverance that you were so delivered from. Can we have a real conversation today? So I begin to ask God how people see me. How do they see me? And you know, those are questions, are loaded questions when you ask those questions. Because sometimes the answer will be favorable, and sometimes it won't be. So God started out by Monday morning showing me something favorable. Because I asked this question for the past week or so. One of the things God showed me is sometimes you get so concerned with your presentation of his truth that you feel the need to put disclaimers on it. Explanation? You ever went to somebody, gave them a word, and you were uncomfortable giving them that word, so then you start needing to explain to them why you said it, and, you know, I need you to understand this ain't really me, this is God, and, you know, I'm just... God showed me that I can be guilty of that when it comes to people I care about. And he said, I need you to totally learn to stay out of my business. And my response to God was, how do I stay out of your business when you're telling me to handle your business and go say this thing? Then the other thing was, I was leaving here Monday morning of last week. We stopped across the street at the new diner to get something to eat on the road. And the woman behind the counter, who's she's one of the owners. She had seen Angela before. She had seen me before, but now she saw us together, so she understood this was my wife. And she began to talk to Angela about me and my presence. And these are those moments when God is the most effective, when we're not aware that we're being used. Figured you'd like that. So here's what she said in her broken English. She said to Angela, "Your husband's a very nice man." Now, I come in the store and I order food and I say hola when I come in and I say God bless you when I leave. That's the depth of my relationship, at least in my mind. But in her mind, she said, the first day we opened, which I had no way of knowing if it was the first day, he came in. She said, for her new restaurant, she's scared, she's confused, she's trying to explain the words to say, I took this thing on because I believe it was God's direction to do so. But she was petrified, scared. Doors are open, no customers are coming in yet. What have I done here? She says, then your husband came in and she began to cry behind the counter. And he ordered his food, and I did this, not trying to be Christian or spiritual, just feeling led in my spirit. I stood in the middle of the restaurant and began to proclaim blessings over the place. That I pray that you're successful and that God prosper your business and it multiplies. And she began to weep, and Mama began to get emotional with her. And she said, it was like God was speaking directly to me, like God sent you here because he knew my fears to speak comfort to me. She said she went home, she told her husband, she said, when you left the store, I started to cry. And when I went home and told my husband, I started to cry. And then she's telling the story again, she starts to cry. I don't think I did anything that was a big deal. But for her, it was a life raft and tumultuous water. See, God could use me because I wasn't in it. God could use me the most powerful because I couldn't interject apology or disclaimer or even get into a debate and rebuttal with somebody because I didn't know I was being used. Then God showed me something else. And I'm giving you these stories about me because I can't talk about you. I don't know what God's doing with you. I can only tell you what he's doing with me. Me and my wife got here about 2 in the morning on Friday night, or Saturday morning, actually. And we got in, you know, the kitchen and everything's still of a mess because we just starting to put everything back together. And she comes in, she says, I'm hungry, I'm making me a shake, and I'm going to bed. She makes her shake, and she kind of says to me, in so many words, I left the stuff on the counter, pretty much you on your own, if you want something to drink, pretty much. I know when she's giving me the hint, don't ask me to do nothing because I'm not doing it, I'm going to bed. I got the message loud and clear. Then she mentioned, you know, the refrigerator door handle is loose. I said, yeah, they installed it wrong. And I immediately went and grabbed my tools at 2:30 in the morning and got some cork and began to devise a way to fix the knob so it wouldn't rattle anymore. And she said, what is that you put in? I said, it's cork. It's like bathroom tub cork. She said, you know, around the bathroom tub, those openings, I can't stand looking at them. So I immediately went in the bathroom and got in the tub and began to cork the tub. And as she was standing there looking at me corking, she said, so what do you want in your shake? You feel that, right? Again, I wasn't doing anything. I wasn't trying to make a point or a message. I was being me. If I'm in your house and you point to something and say that's broke, if I got tools with me, I'm going to climb up on the ladder right now and fix it. That's just me. If I can do it, I'm going to do it. Here's my point. She saw me serving her without question, without debate. I said, well, I'm tired. I'll do that in the morning. I immediately went to fixing it. And maybe it said something to her like, you know, you being so tacky, go make the guy shake. You made yourself one. I don't know what the Spirit of God said to her, how it ministered to her. All I know is because I was just behaving out of what God has made me, it affected her response. Because I just went to the store and was the person that God has made me, it touched her life and ministered to her. We, as a body of Christ, need to come to a real revelation. And that is this. Say this with me. I am here for the sole purpose of being God's minister. I think we get caught up in the events of life to the point that we forget what our prime directive is. So we become more concerned with representing Christianity than being Christians. We'll see, when it's quiet like that, it's like, oh, he just threw one right over our heads again. We get more concerned about how we look Christian and how we're acting Christian than being Christian. We get more concerned about the show or the public display of Christianity than allowing Christ to grow in us and change us. Rachel's the only just come out of teenager here, so I'm going to use you. So you're grown, but you're still at home, but you're coming into yourself, but you're not so far away from do this, do that, do this, do that, instruction, that's wrong, that's sin, that's not what you're supposed to be. You're Christian, I didn't raise you that way, blah, blah, blah. You're still close enough to that to understand the struggle is the word. This is who you're telling me I should be versus this is who I feel I should be. Or this is who I want to be. This is who you're telling me. This is what I feel inside. Right or wrong, still is right to you at this time because you're doing your own sorting. You're finding out who you are separate from who parents tell you you should be. Can you remember this? Now, we get so sometimes caught up in projecting the lifestyle, we neglect to pass on the relationship. You can only pass on the relationship by your behavior, not by your conversation. Boy, it's quiet up in the piece today. See, I'm learning and I've learned that even watching as my son start to come into his manhood, like, you can't tell him anything else. He's already come into who he is. Now, everything you say to him has to be a reflection that he sees when he looks in the mirror called you. Nothing I say is going to be new, different, or profound. He's heard it all. I mean, if you're still doing your Christian parenting, they've heard it all. Kamali's heard it all. She's seen it all. She knows what you say in church. She knows what you say at home. She's already come to a conclusion about you as a parent, as a Christian, as a whatever, and made her decisions about herself based on what she's seen, good or bad, right? Both. We want the kids just to take the good, but they take the full scope. They do. They see you when you're not so Christian. And they hear what you're telling them they should be, and then they're interpreting what you are when you're not in that mode. You telling me I shouldn't be this, but you laugh at the same jokes that I laugh at, and you watch the same kind of movies that I watch, and they have the same rating. And the sad thing is when they know when they're small, when you're trying to keep them from seeing it, God don't want them seeing this, so I want to watch it when they're sleeping. But still, the behavior is what's going to be mimicked, not the instruction. Am I too deep here? Is this simple enough? So, I want you to turn with me to Romans chapter 15. And let's talk about, with the word, who we are and why we're put here. Let me know when you're there. Romans chapter 15. Starting at verse 1, it says, "Now, we who are strong in our convictions and faith ought to patiently put up with the weakness of those who are not as strong and not just please ourselves," saying not just please ourselves. See, the word said just. So that means God doesn't have a problem with you doing things that please you. But he's talking about the not just. Let's not be so focused on that. Let us be focused on why God put us here. And that is to be patient and to help those who are not as strong as we perceive ourselves to be. Well, let each one of us make it a practice to please his neighbor for his good, and to build him up spiritually. Well, for even Christ did not please himself, but as it is written in the scripture, the reproaches of those who reproach you, the Father, fell on me, the Son. Now let's stop with this a second. Whenever you see "for as it is written" in the New Testament, it's talking about the Old Testament. See, Jesus wasn't reading, or the disciples weren't reading the New Testament and quoting from the New Testament because it was being written as they were sending these letters out. So when he says, even Jesus didn't please himself and gives a scripture for the reproaches that reproach you fell on me, they're showing, are you listening? Christ before Christ was born. These men are coming to the realization that these scriptures that we've studied in what was then not the only old, wasn't the Old Testament, it was the scripture. There was no old new, it was the scripture. They are now identifying that this is talking about the Christ who we have with us right now. Why is that point important? Ask me why. I don't think you really want to know. Ask me again. Okay. Because they were, listening to me now, coming aware of the fact that the Christ that presently walked with them or just recently left them was the Messiah that they had been seeking all their lives. And they're writing out of this amazement and astonishment. You got this? Wow. He said this, and he did this. Oh, wow. That he was fishing with us. You understand? Christians have a tendency today not to understand the Christ who's walking with them until he's gone. They don't usually get it to way after the fact. We have a tendency to miss the Jesus when he's right there with us and 2 years later and we go, wow, the Lord was with me all along. This is the revelation that these people are having. Missing God in the moment, always realizing him after the fact. Just say it to me like you mean, like, I don't want to be that person anymore. I don't either. I want to see Christ in his presence. I want to see him in the now. I want to work on now. Faith is the substance. I want to know that God is moving right when he's moving, and I want to be moving with him in flow. I don't want it to be later, and then I'm writing out, wow, wasn't it something when he said, remember when the disciple says, when Jesus appeared himself to him, he walked with him after he was resurrected, and then he left, they said, didn't our hearts burn within us? Why, like, again, after he was gone, oh, wow, that was Jesus. Say it again. I want to be in the present with him. This is the place pastor's in right now. God, how many times have you moved and then I realized it was your move after you moved? Come on now. Can I get a witness? Good God. Hey. I digress. For verse 4, whatever was written in the earlier times was written for our instruction. See, so he's talking about now the Old Testament. So that through endurance and encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope and overflow with confidence in his promises. He's saying, so these things were written for us now, O New Testament, that we could see and have hope of the overflow or the things that are coming or the other things that have been promised that are still to come. The word of God is given to us to be a source of encouragement and something to help us hold on to the promises that were set before us. Are you with me? So that means we have an obligation to anchor ourselves in those promises and find faith to keep us going in times that things don't look so right. But the beginning starts off with an instruction of what we're supposed to be doing in the meantime. See, these are not random thoughts. They go together. They're saying, don't be so concerned about pleasing yourself. Get busy doing what God needs you to do to be a help to your brother or sister as they're weaker and struggling. And in the process of that, understand that these great and precious promises will be manifested while you're doing your job. If you feel under a lot of pressure right now and you feel like a lot of things are not going the way you should be going and you feel the weight of the world kind of pressing on you, then maybe you're too focused on your issues and pleasing yourself, and maybe you need to find out who you should be ministering to keep you distracted from what's happening around you while God is taking care of that with his promises. Now, have you ever had that experience where God has dropped something in your lap, somebody else in your lap, to get yourself off of you while he was doing what he was doing? It's like him putting Abraham to sleep as he walked through the cut pieces because he didn't want Abraham getting involved, because we already know Abraham meddled too much. He was already slowing down the birth of the child by 20 plus years. So God's like, okay, for this one here, I'm just going to knock you out. So I could do this without you saying, well, there's blood over there, though. Are you sure you want to walk up? Do you want me to wash that? You know, Abraham was one of them kind of people. I could be that kind of person. I want to help God. But I want to help him by telling him what to do. I want to help him by doing what he's doing with him as if I know what he's doing. No, we hung out enough. I know what you're trying to do. I got you, God. Let me help. God's like, sit yourself down somewhere. Go do something else. Go help somebody else. The scripture tells you to help those who are weaker. I'm not weaker. Go help somebody weaker. Stop trying to help me bring things to pass. I'm hearing a lot of mms, ohs. Ah, Amen. If it's helping you, say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Good. Verse 5. Now, may the God who gives endurance and who supplies encouragement grant that you be of the same mind with one another according to Christ Jesus. This is a powerful verse. And I don't want to just, but see, these are kind of verses that we kind of just roll over till we find that one that goes, ooh. But I'm finding all the oohs in these little ones that we just kind of read through as just, these are, you know, these are usually the build-up verses. We're waiting for the punchline. But there's a punchline in here. Watch. Now, may the God give endurance, who supplies encouragement, grant you the same mind. So he's saying to you, be encouraged by the promises. And he's asking that God who supplies that encouragement grant that to you so that you could be the same mind with one another according to Jesus Christ. So here's what I'm saying. Here's what I'm saying. What I took from this is, so in order for me to be one mind with you, I need encouragement. In order for me to get along, that's one mind. It's to get along, to be in agreement, to have the same heart, a godly heart about things with you. With you and words. I have to have, are you catching this? Encouragement from God in order to do that. You don't bear witness with that? You find it as a walk with the Lord, some of the hardest things to do is agree with other believers. Am I wrong? That's a lot of time the hardest thing. I ain't talking about agree with pastor. I'm talking about trying to get a group of Christians in a room to all agree on the same thing. Well, I believe the Lord told me, I don't know. You need to have some wisdom. I would pray about it. I did pray about it, idiot. That's why I'm telling you what God told me. Well, I don't know. I think you should pray again. I think the Lord is telling you, me, that such a, that maybe, okay, well, that's what he told you. Why are you messing with what he told me? And then here we go. Everybody want to be deep and spiritual and have a word. Well, let me just read a verse to you that I just read last night. Okay, you know you didn't. You just looked up the scripture of the day and now you're quoting it like you found something deep. Stop trying to act. Come on. So he's saying, God gives me endurance. Somebody say endurance. You know what endurance is? Huh? Stamina, the ability to keep going in the area of what? Being of the same mind. No. You're still not getting this. You're not getting this. Christ and God and the Holy Spirit, one mind. That's what makes them powerful. One mind. The Tower of Babel, the issue was they were of one mind and nothing that they desired to do would be impossible for them. So their language had to be confounded to keep them from doing that which was wrong. Because they were in agreement on being wrong or doing something unholy. But God said because they're of one mind, you cannot stop them. In the book of Acts, there's another place where they talked about the believers all got together and they were praying and the room began to shake because they were all of one mind and one accord. See, the fall of the church is, or the stumbling of the church or the mishaps of the church is not about doctrine. It's about lack of unity. Satan destroys us and keeps us from being powerful for lack of unity. If you think I'm wrong, pick any church, walk in it and stay in it for 5 hours and see if you can find total unity anywhere in the church. I'm not even talking about across denominations. I'm talking about in one church. If you can't define difference of opinion, we're a small group. And I guarantee you right now, I can start talking to every one of you, and I know most of you personally enough to know where we don't agree. Now, what kind of power of God do you think you're going to see in that? We can't get together. Everybody says, get together, let's pray for somebody's healing. If you ask each person what they believe in, you'll find out none of you are believing for the same thing. One person believes for God to come down like a miracle and just do a magic trick and make them healed. Another person thinks God's going to give you a special word and you're going to lay hands on them and they're going to get healed. Another person says, no, I'm going to be the one that's going to lay hands on them because I'm the anointed one and that's when they're going to get healed. No, I'm going to have a special word and everybody want to be the star of the show and there's no unity. And that's why people dying in church. It's no one accord. It's no unity. Well, I'm going to do the praise dance. Well, but the pastor said I could do that praise dance, and you have to do the other. And just the simplest things, who going to get to sing the solo? No unity. Now, you might think I'm picking, but I'm not picking. You might think I'm trying to be funny, but I'm not trying to be funny. I'm trying to show you where the power halt or where the surge protector has flipped and there's no power flowing through the church anymore. I'm trying to show you from my studies what God has been showing me, the lack of unity and oneness in the house. You can't get a group of believers to stand for the same thing about nothing, and that's why the church is not as powerful as it should be or used to be. We're not trying to help somebody else with their week. If we are, we're trying to tell them what we think they should do. We have our ideas of how it should be, and we want to make sure you get it. How are we doing?
Not so well.
So, the key is this. There's an encouragement that God grants us and an endurance to have the same mind. Say, it's an encouragement, and there's a needed endurance to be of one mind. You understand that now? It's not as simple as, well, let's just agree in prayer. Let's get an agreement. I think that's become the biggest joke in the church right now. Let's just get an agreement. And then that means let's get in our circle and pray. Without stopping to say, okay, so what are we agreeing on? And people who have asked me for prayer have heard me say, so what are we agreeing on? What scripture are you standing on? Well, I just want you to pray for me and get mad when I don't take them up on that. Why? Because then I'm going to look stupid because it's going to look like I prayed for you and nothing happened. We ain't in agreement in the first place. I need to know what you're agreeing on. I need to know. Sherry, remember the operation? Everybody was telling you what you should do and shouldn't do and believe and not believe. And she had to have a heart operation. This was serious business. And Sherry was feeling all confused because she felt like maybe she's not being a good Christian because she ain't just believing for God to heal her. Listen to me. Look at me. That's not what she believed. That's what she was pressured to feel she should believe by people who were standing in agreement with her. Am I correct? People so-called standing in agreement were in agreement on what date she should be believing, not asking her what she believed. When she called me, I said, Sherry, you can die doing that. Now let me ask you, what do you believe? She said, I believe in my heart I shall have the operation and I will heal miraculously and God will move and the doctors will be amazed by that. I said, and what's wrong with that? She said, I just feel like it's wrong. I said, no, you don't feel like it's wrong. They told you it's wrong. I'm telling you that that's enough. If that's where your faith is, then we need to go in on that faith. We can't go on what people think you should believe. We need to go in on what you believe. Right? And we did. And you had a heart operation, and I came to the hospital the next day, and you was ready out the bed sitting in the chair and eating. I'm like, wait a minute, you out the bed already? But this is what you believed for. That's where your faith was. I had to agree with her. So when we helping those who are weaker, we are not helping them to see it our way. Let's help them stand on anything first. I'll ask people, so what can you believe for? Well, I believe, okay, you're too churched. I don't want to hear your church view. Is this helpful? Tell me what you can believe. Is this really helpful? T-
Tell me what you can believe, because then I can agree with you and we can see something. Then the next time you might want to go for the bigger piece of the pie. But for right now, if you just want a small slice, don't force people to try to stand in your faith. You're going to hurt somebody. It's quiet in here today. The power of God is not displayed in conversation. It's displayed in manifestation. I'll say it again. It's not displayed in conversation. It's displayed in manifestation. Me confessing what I believe is not the power of God. People seeing it manifest. So the confession is important, but the manifestation is what we see and what we hold to. Can I get a witness on this? I'm going to give you an example physically. I thought Mitchell would be over in his little corner and he could assist me, but either Rachel or Rhonda, can we get that light switch right there? Not the one at the door, the one right here. So we're going to have a little blackout for those. Are these lights on or off? Okay, let's see. Let's see how we stand about that. What about now? He said, the lights are on. They're on. No? Okay, wait, what about now? In Jesus' name. What about now? Turn them on. Ah. So me holding up this sign doesn't make a difference. Just like you running around yelling, I'm healed and delivered in Jesus' name, don't mean nothing to nobody if they can't see it. Shouting that you're saved, you're healed, you're delivered, you're blessed, you're prosperous in Jesus' name, don't make it so to nobody. If it's true, you don't have to say it. They see it. Amen. The church has gotten a practice of this. They don't need proof. They don't need the example that everybody can see. They figure if they say it in Jesus' name, it's enough. And then when you don't receive it, they shout it at you in Jesus' name. I don't receive that. I'm him. Jesus' name. Doesn't make it so. It just makes it your position. Not saying it's a bad position. It's just yours. It's not mine until it manifests. Did you catch that? That's your position, and you should have a position. But don't fault me for not accepting your position when you have no light that I can see. You got that one, huh? Unity comes in us walking together with the same call and the same desire, the same hope. Okay. I accept. You can't wake up today, tomorrow, and now decide that you're going to get along with everybody. But can we start with a few people? No, this is an important statement I'm making here. Because Christians don't stand in unity with anybody. I find people who agree with me, and these are the people I roll with. And the people that agree with you, if you really get down to it, don't agree with you. They may get along with you. They learn how to tolerate you, and you learn how to tolerate each other. But when you start to really find out if you guys are one accord, one heart, same mind, you start to find out that, no. That's why you have a friend, and you say, it's my best friend, and then you have one argument, and all of a sudden, you're like, I don't speak to that B. Come on now. This is my best friend. Oh, my God, I love them. But now you have one disagreement. I don't talk to them. Why? Nah, because some crap they said. But I thought you were the best of friends. So you were never in unity. You were never in agreement. There was never a harmony. You had a relationship that was temporal at most. This is what we've become as a people. And I'm not chewing you out. I'm guilty of all the stuff I'm saying. But what I'm trying to explain is that, you know,
I have a question.
Okay, let's break tradition. Ask your question.
How do we accomplish that? How do we be in unity?
How do we be in unity? Right, no, this is, no, okay. Lord, just help us out. Now, she asked a question. So since I open the floor to the question, I'm going to open the floor to some answers. I don't want to just stand here and just spoon feed everything to you. Give me some thoughts. How do we do that? How do we accomplish this place of unity? How do we come to this place where we can be of the same mind and heart? Yes, Mike.
First, by being honest as to where we are.
That's a good start. He said, first, by being honest to where we are, meaning in ourselves.
Yeah.
Looking at our flaws and honestly accepting our shortcomings. That's powerful.
Well, I can agree with you. I got to know where.
You got to know where you stand.
You got to know where I stand.
I'll take that. That's a powerful statement. Did you? You going to say the same thing? Similar? Well, if it was similar, then it's a little bit different. Let me hear what yours was.
So being in with somebody, like, you have to know what you're saying to them. You got to talk.
You got to talk. There has to be a dialogue.
There
has to be a real conversation.
Right.
Now, there could be a conversation, and then somebody gets insulted by the conversation, and it becomes a conflict, and then what happens? Because conversations, hey, let's have a conversation. Then we sit down and have a conversation, and then you say something I don't like, and then all of a sudden, conversation turns to a fight. So it's more than just a conversation. There's something that we need to come to the conversation with then.
You
have the same goals. That's a good start. Yes, I like that. Come on, let's go. Just the people in the front are spiritual? Come on, just throw anything out. None of us know. Let's just throw it out. Listen. No stupid answer at this point. Anything is better than what we got. Like Trump said, look, you get killed anyway. What you got to lose? I hate quoting that dude. But nonetheless, sometimes he says some funny stuff that has some truth to it. Okay, so come on, let's go for it. Throw me some stuff. Yes, Jackie. I like that. Mutual respect. The key word is respect, right? Respect each other's differences enough that I can talk to you and we don't see it on the same level, but we don't lose respect for one another. Love that. That's good. Yes, Angie. I like that. A foundation. I got to say it because the people can't hear you. A foundation of solid communication that continues to grow. Continue.
Also a foundation of trust.
That's the word I was looking for. A foundation of trust. If we don't have trust, how could we ever come to that place? If you don't trust my heart and I don't trust your heart, I think you're saying something, okay, what you trying to do? All right, here you go, trying to get over on me. And if that's what I'm thinking, how can I ever be in one accord with you? How can I ever think that you looking out for my good when you say something, I think you up to no good? These are the reasons that the church is not unified. There's no trust. There's no foundation. There's no conversation. There's no respect, mutual respect for one another. There's no desire to see what's wrong with me. And fortunately and unfortunately, to your point, sometimes if you're willing to see what's wrong with you, people think, oh, now this is a good reason for me to pile on now. So then since you're willing to see it, let me just rip you apart now. So you can't trust. So if the trust is, you got to trust the person that you're willing to be real with is willing to help you get to the next side. I'm not going to be comfortable putting my stuff out there if I know you don't really care about me. I'm not going to look for your help when I know every time I ask you for help, you're trying to see what's in it for you. So we have some bridges here, don't we? I wish I could give you a one-sentence answer and hocus pocus this, but the bottom line is the scripture said that's why we pray for endurance. That's what it says, right? That we pray for endurance. We have to have the ability to, one, endure one another, and two, be encouraged. So let's start with this one. Can we first at least just trust God to be true to his word, to be honest with us that everything he's doing is for our better good, that he is not going to use the information we give him to try to cut our throat? Can we have an honest dialogue with God? All the stuff we talked about right now. Forget people first. Let's start with God, because some of us still try to hide from God. Some of us still don't believe that God's promised outcome is what he really means. So we can't do it with one another until we get it right with God. I got to be willing to let God hear me express my faults without shame. I got to be willing to allow God to point my faults out to me, without me getting comfortable and wanting to close the Bible and go watch TV. These are real conversations. There has to be a dialogue between us. And the cool thing about it with God is you're starting out in a good place, because you're not hiding nothing anyway. He already knows it all. So you just might as well, for your sake, come clean, because God already knows. Did this help somebody? Did that help you a little bit there? I hope I got you at least on the road to it, because if you want a full answer from me, I don't think the people who wrote this had the full answer. I think they was writing it as the Spirit was giving it to them and hoping that they was okay. But if this is blessing you, I'm happy. Okay, verse 6. So that with one accord, you may with one voice glorify and praise and honor God the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, continue to accept and welcome one another. Do you see how much this is about that? Just as Jesus Christ has accepted and welcomed us to the glory of our great God. For I tell you, this is important here. For I tell you that Christ has become a servant and a minister to the circumcision, the Jews, on behalf of God's truth, to confirm and verify the promises of the Father, and for the Gentiles to glorify God for his mercy to them. I know this is confusing, but I'm going to explain it. Since God has no remnant with them, as it is written and forever remains. Now, before I get into as it's written and forever remain, let me tell you in plain English what he just said. You don't have no right to ask God for nothing, because you have no part of him. Jesus came to walk and live out the circumcision for those who are circumcised, the Jew, because that's who he was and that's what he came as. But then he also bridged the gap by becoming a sacrifice for us, so that now we have a relationship with that God. So basically saying, you have no right to ask God for anything or to even have a relationship, because he has no covenant with you. But because of Jesus' obedience, because Jesus came and put us first, that like he's telling us to do for people, and put us first and walked for us and died for us, we now have part of a covenant that we once did not have a part of. Now, with the short time I got left, I didn't think I would go this long. Let me just explain something to you. The biggest atrocity in the world is religion. And I'm going to tell you why I say that. Because somehow through the course of religion, you're listening to me? You're listening to me? Yeah. A Christian is a Christian and a Jew is a Jew. And that wasn't God's intention. We're talking about now religious beliefs and stance. But it was this one God. Hear me out now. Hear me out now. Who had a covenant with a people. Listen to me now. Say the word covenant. Because this is where I think I'm going to have to wrap today for the sake of time. Jeff today talked about being the bride of Christ when he was up here. It was so interesting and powerful that he brought this up. Because the word bride is not about male or female, it's about covenant. That's what the word represents in the Bible. It's translated English bride. But in the original language, it's covenant or marriage covenant. It's a covenant. There were covenants that people made with one another in terms of protection and financial support and families. And this is a covenant. And those covenants, those people would soon die and break those covenants. You follow me? Now, he's saying, I am God. And this is where the religions have all of them have a truth to it. There's only one God, all religions, da, da, da. No, after you started creating your doctrine is where it went wrong. Church people might not want to hear this, but let's hear it. Ishmael is Abraham's child, who is God's child. Isaac is Abraham's child, who is God's child. Isaac is the father of the Jews. Ishmael is the father of the Muslims. Let's deal with this now. So originally, yes, we all had the same one God. Can we have this conversation here? This is too risky for Christians. Okay? And then the Christians came in through the Jews, through Christ, who's a Jew who grafted us in. One God. We then created our little doctrines and beliefs and started playing the separation game. But the truth of the matter is, we are Jews. The truth of the matter is, we are Jews. Or else we're not part of the covenant. Doesn't the scripture say we've been grafted in? What, the fruit that was once not part of the tree is now part of the tree. He didn't make a new tree. Okay, so here's what I'm going to have. I'm going to have my Jews here, and I have my Christians over there. That's not the way God ever intended it to be. That's what man did with it. Well, Jews it is. And no, Jews have a covenant. I'm not talking about people who say I'm Jewish because my mommy and daddy was Jewish. Just like you ain't a Christian because your mommy and daddy is a Christian. But Jews who follow that covenant are covered under Abraham. Scripture says that. I don't care what you think. Stop saying Jews are going to hell. You don't know what you're talking about. Because if they're going to hell, it says in the book of Galatians, then where are you going? Because you're grafted in through them. So send them the hell you go into. You got put into the same tree. And by the way, Jesus was Jew. To the letter. He didn't become Messiah so that we could separate. He came Messiah so we could unify and become one body. Not one body of Christians and one body of Jews. See, this is when you start banging on people's doors. Because the devil works in division. The first thing he promoted to start the fall of man was division. It's the woman you gave me. Immediately, a transference of issues and blame and whatever. The woman you gave me, she caused the problem. We was doing good until you brought her in here. You understand what I'm saying? Immediately a division. And if you read the book, God did not pronounce sin until that statement was made. He asked, what have you done? Why did you hide? And the moment that statement was made, he said, and because of that, you will do this. You will, by the labor of hands, you will suffer pain in childbirth. All of this stuff start to happen. All of these statements start to come out. Now, I'm not saying it's that's the total why. I'm just following the progression of the scripture. He didn't come right away and say, sin, you're going to fall, you're going to do this. No, he asked the question first. He gave the man the chance to repent and own himself, and he did not. And then the pronunciation of the curses that came with it followed. So here's where I want to bring this home today. He's saying you are not at all of this tribe or of this branch. But then he goes on to say, and these are the verses I want to get in before I close up, because these are so important. Okay, let me go back to 9. And for the Gentiles, so he said Jesus came and took his place for the Jews. He said that and lived it out. And for the Gentiles, to glorify God, listen to this, for the Gentiles to glorify God, listen to this again, for the Gentiles to glorify God. So he did this for the Gentiles to glorify God, for his mercy. Say, I glorify God for his mercy. Now we're going to talk about that mercy. To them, since God had no covenant with them. Do you see that? No covenant with us. Do you see it? As it was written and forever remains, and now he's going to Old Testament. Therefore, I praise you amongst the Gentiles and sing praises to your name. Do you hear this? He's already in the Old Testament before Jesus came. Has this in here. And again, he said, rejoice and celebrate, O Gentiles, along with his people. Let's read that again. Rejoice and celebrate, O Gentiles, along with the Jews. Yes? Yes? Any disagreeers on this? This is what he's saying. These are my people. You have no covenant with me. But through Christ, I want you to celebrate and rejoice along with my people. Well, something becomes clear to me as I bring this home. Let's read that last verse too. Let's get all the Old Testament ones in. And again, he says, praise the Lord, all you Gentiles, and let his people praise him. Let all the people, I mean, and let all people, the people praise him. Now, there is a root of Jesse who arises to rule as king over the Gentiles, and him shall the Gentiles hope. Now, this blows my mind. He says a root of Jesse. This is Old Testament. This is what they read. The Jews who really read the books knew that there was going to be a root of Jesse that was going to come along, and through him, the Gentiles will now be part of us. Are you listening to me? Well, let's talk about this root of Jesse. You know who Jesse is? Father of David. Thank you, Angie. Thank you. All right? So that's Jesse. Jesse's David's father. David is Jesus' great-great-grandfather. So now that we understand this, there was a hope for those who paid attention to the hope and not the religion, that there was a one who would come through Jesse's lineage who would bring the Gentiles in. Let me tell you why we can't unify, Rhonda. Because we don't even want to have a relationship with the ones we were born in to be a part of. We want to be Christians, not them folks, them Jews. Oh, really? Oh, I learned this a long time ago. I've never been anti-Jewish, and I don't like anti-Jewish remarks. But some of these Jewish people, I'm not talking about Jewish people or people who call themselves Jewish people, because if you don't serve the Lord by his word and you don't live under the covenant of a Jewish person, you're just calling yourself Jew as a race. And that's up to you. You got a right to call yourself that if you want to. But a Jew is those who practice it. And you're never going to get me to badmouth them. Never. Never, ever, 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 ever. We see them walking around here and they say, they ain't real Jews. They didn't, with them white guys with the thing. You go ahead and you make your own distinctions. If they're serving the Lord in that capacity, then that's brethren to me, and you're not going to get me to badmouth them. I don't care what you think about them. Maybe that's why I prosper better than most people I know. I'm not going to badmouth them. He said, you bless those who bless them and curse those who curse them, and I'm not going to try to decide which ones. If you say you are, I'm going to be good enough to say, look, if you're willing to walk around with that hat on and that thing hanging down, you got to be real to some degree. Because I wouldn't wear that. So I'm just saying, if you're willing to go through all of that, I'm just going to accept it and call you brother and leave it alone. If the Muslim would stop fighting them and just join them, they'll be covered under Abraham's covenant. You see how stupid this has become? We're divided as a people in the church, but we're divided from our roots. So I'll say this to you. Do not let people put negative words in your mouth about anybody else in their religion. Just don't. I don't care how much they're pumping it on the news right now and banning this thing. And I know Christians are going, well, it ain't us, so that ain't our problem. Listen, it could start with one and turn to 50 others. I'm not celebrating anybody being mistreated by anybody. Not doing it. Not going to do it. And I'm not going to start speaking against people thinking I have a right to stand in judgment over other people because they don't believe exactly as I believe. I'm not going to do it. Well, so how do you, so you're saying everybody could be saved? I don't say who could be saved. That's not my call. I know God told me it's through Jesus Christ, and I know that's how I got in the covenant, and that's where I'm staying. You believe what you want to believe, that's where I'm staying. But I'm not going to turn my nose up at other people to think that I have the audacity to judge and condemn anybody. But that's how division starts. And it started there, and it filtered its way right into the church. So then the church said, well, let's have different denominations. Let's be Baptists and Pentecosts and this one and that one and that and this one and now, and we don't agree with it. So now they're even agreeing with each other. But understand something. That's Satan's job. He's a great deceiver. He tries to deceive you. If you really think his focus is on deceiving you individually, you're missing the whole fight. His job is to deceive the nations. And I have to say to the enemy, well done. I started saying months ago, church, it's time to wake up. Let's just not walk around with that kind of heart toward anyone. Let's let God judge. Let our light shine, as I started this message, that people see the Christ in us, because we're not walking around saying, I'm a Christian, I love Jesus, but because a simple thing is I just stood in her restaurant and blessed her restaurant and prayed success for them. Not knowing that it made any difference, not even trying to be a Christian, I just did because I felt it was the right thing to do for somebody. And let the love of God shine. Look at me when I say this, because it's the last thing I'm going to say. Let the love of God that's in you shine. I know that it's in you already. I'm not telling you it needs to be. I'm not saying you need to get more love of Jesus. I know every one of you. I'm telling you the love of God is in you. I see it. Stop being concerned about impressing anybody and just let who you are shine through you. Amen. 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 Thank you for your time.